So walking is good for us. It's good for our health. It's good for our mind. But for most of us, we have to find ways to motivate and some would say trick ourselves into moving our bodies when it is not out of necessity. We do this because expending energy for almost the entirety of human history was expensive. Humans have had to reckon with the basics of this supply, usually not enough, and demand, usually too much, for as long as we have been humans. This is encoded in us through millions of years of evolution. So for millennia, minimizing physical effort wasn't just an act of laziness or leisure time, it was a matter of survival. And so we have evolved a desire to rest and a need to avoid exertion. But first through agriculture and then through industrialization, we have escaped the bounds placed on us as biological organisms that required significant and consistent energy expenditures to maintain our bodies and feed our young. Agriculture was the first innovation that upended this evolutionary balance, the ability to grow, harvest, and store excess calories over what could be naturally acquired from individual locations, transformed human societies from hunters and gatherers to farmers, herders, and city dwellers. And here you see the spread of agriculture that occurred thousands of years ago across Europe, Asia, and Africa. And human labor became intensively applied in permanent locations rather than extensively and lightly applied across large areas. So cities grew out of this revolution and are themselves reflections of this need to conserve energy. People that live closer together have easier access to more goods, more services, and more people than if those things are further apart. The Industrial Revolution added a new axis of complexity to the fundamental energy expenditure equation. New transportation technologies completely released humans from the mobility constraints imposed by living organisms, whether from the animals we were able to domesticate and use for transport, or our own 2 feet. But the resulting effects on cities and the attendant effects on our planet have been enormous. Generally, in older cities, these transportation revolutions took place within the context of the existing building and transportation networks that were both intentionally and unintentionally designed to be convenient for walking. So to satisfy the fundamental desire to minimize physical effort, but while also exploiting humanity's newfound ability to literally annihilate space and time through fast travel, industrialized modes of transportation, whether on steel rails or in the streets, worked around, squeezed into, or tunneled underneath most of the existing built environment. But in newer cities, the story is much more complicated. I'll focus here on the US since it's our home, but also because the consequences of this process, based on the US experience, are now having the largest effects on the Earth's climate system. So one overarching assumption I'm working from is that the way modern cities are built, formed, expanded, and sometimes abandoned, will for the most part result from choices humans have made. Relatedly, these choices are reflective in some way of our values as a society. So for instance, we can choose to build cities with giant parks in the middle of them, like Central Park in New York City. Or we can choose to build cities with giant highways in the middle of them, like is going on right now in Houston, Texas. So dismantling a streetcar line, as was done in cities all over the US, including in Raleigh, in the early 20th century, was a choice. Requiring or prohibiting certain kinds of buildings or houses or uses in certain areas, and this is called zoning, is a choice we make. These choices, particularly when codified in law and in professional practice, have the effect of forming a system or systems that govern how cities and the people that live in them function. And really importantly, these choices can then make other choices people make seem like natural expressions of preferences when they're actually now requirements of the urban system that we have created. So here's an example from a suburban city in Florida where it's pretty clear that we have chosen to prioritize movement by car over all other forms of transportation. So learning about these urban systems and the physical, social, and ecological relationships that define and influence or are defined and influenced by them could take up an entire course or a degree program or a career. And it includes fields as varied as urban planning, sociology, history, anthropology, archaeology, geography, engineering, and so on and so on. So for those of you interested, there's a whole world to explore about this topic. Now, over the last century, in the US, we have chosen to mostly focus on building an automobile-based transportation system. By choosing to build infrastructure that's meant for travel by personal vehicle, we have encouraged the growth of a very particular kind of city. What I'm showing here is the amount of developed area, meaning suburbs and cities in the triangle, so Raleigh, Durham, Chapel Hill, and comparing that built up area to the urban area within Barcelona, Spain. And you can see that it's a big difference then in terms of the amount of area it takes up, but also then how much greenhouse gases are emitted across these two cities and how much greenhouse gases are emitted per person. Even though Barcelona has more people than the triangle, there's almost 10 times as many greenhouse gases emitted per person in our region compared to Barcelona, given the kind of city we've chosen to build here. This type of city not only allows for car travel, but typically requires it in order to participate and function in society. This required mobility mode is most obvious in the suburbs. Now, the word suburb is so ubiquitous that it's hard to come up with a single definition. But for our purposes, let's define it as any urban area with a preponderance of, we'll call it single unit housing, and segregation of use types through zoning. So use types being those things like housing, commercial businesses, industry like factories, government buildings, etc. And here we have the actual zoning map for Raleigh. Notice all the yellow that's shown here. These are all areas where only houses are allowed. No other type of use is permitted in these regions. Suburbs are now so common in the US that roughly one third of the population lives in suburbs. And so here you can see what this looks like across the US and how this has changed over time. So urban counties and suburban counties, they do make up a large proportion, now over half of the United States population, and that's been growing over time. And even though they don't take up a huge amount of the land compared to rural areas, they are where most of the people live. And you can see how suburban counties are growing even faster than urban counties across the US. Now, there are many reasons why our society has chosen to build out suburban cities. Some of these reasons have to do with covert and overt racism, unfortunately, while others, but still related reasons, stem from 19th century notions of this ideal middle-class life that is striving to replicate the feel of, you know, of all things, medieval English manorial estates. When automobile ownership became possible for large numbers of people in the 20th century, a feedback cycle developed where more people owned cars, which made it more possible for car-oriented suburbs to develop, which encouraged more car-oriented suburban infrastructure, which encouraged more car ownership in order to access the car-oriented infrastructure, and so on. The most obvious consequence of these choices that created our current suburban city system is that car ownership occurs on a massive scale. So here's a chart showing the number of vehicle miles traveled in the US over time. And this has continued to increase to the point where we're now over 3 trillion miles traveled by car in the US every year. there are almost 300 million vehicles in the U.S., nearly enough for every single person, from newborns to centenarians. Unfortunately, this massive car presence does result in large costs borne by our society. For the Earth's climate, the effect is large and growing larger every year. Greenhouse gas emissions from the transportation sector represent 29% of all emissions in the U.S., which means they are the largest single source of emissions in the country and in North Carolina. So larger than all the carbon dioxide produced by power plants, which is about 25% of all emissions. We can break this down even further and just look at emission estimates for cars and trucks, or what we call light-duty vehicles, and exclude things like aviation from airplanes and freight transportation. Even then, vehicles represent 16% of all fossil fuels that we burn, which is 50% more than the entire agricultural sector of the economy. Just for perspective, this also means that cars and trucks in the U.S. burn more fossil fuels than all sources of greenhouse gases in Germany, or about 80% of the total emissions from all of South America, which also has 100 million more people than the U.S. So how do we solve this wicked problem? Well, in part two, I'll talk about some ways that scientists can help society think through these choices confronting us.